This is a picture test in practical anatomy of the upper limb. You may use the video as a revision for the topic or as a self-assessment tool. For the purpose of self-assessment, you may pause the video and spend your own time to read the question and come up with the answer. Then replay the video to confirm your answer by listening to the comments and explanations. Now I will deal with the shoulder region and axilla. Which nerve is related to the notch A? Notch A is called the spinoglenoid notch because it's a notch located between the spine of the scapula and the glenoid cavity, hence the name spinoglenoid notch. And the nerve is the suprascapular nerve as it arises in the supraspinous fossa. It supplies supraspinatus muscle, then curves through the spinoglenoid notch to reach the infraspinous fossa, where it supplies the infraspinatus muscle. Suprascapular nerve arises from the upper trunk of the brachial plexus. And it supplies these two muscles, supraspinatus and infraspinatus muscles. It is accompanied by suprascapular vessels in this course. Identify the muscle A. What is its nerve supply? Muscle A is on the anterior surface of the scapula. It is the subscapularis muscle, and it is supplied by upper and lower subscapular nerves, which are not clearly shown here because they are very small nerves. Identify muscle B. What is its nerve supply? Muscle B is latissimus dorsi muscle. This is the lateral border of latissimus dorsi muscle, and the wide muscle in the back converges here to form a strong ribbon-like tendon that wraps around the lower border of teres major muscle, both forming the posterior axillary fold. The tendon of latissimus dorsi will be attached to the floor of the intertubercular groove of the humerus, and the muscle is supplied by the nerve to latissimus dorsi, or thoracodorsal nerve, from the posterior cord of the brachial plexus. It is this nerve that is flanked on either side by upper and lower subscapular nerves that supply subscapularis muscle. Identify the fossa and name the fibrocartilaginous structure attached at the margin of the fossa. This is the small shallow glenoid fossa that forms a socket for the ball formed by the large head of the humerus. Only one-third of the head articulates in the fossa at a time, making the shoulder joint more mobile but less stable. The glenoid fossa is deepened slightly by a rim of fibrocartilage, which is called the glenoid labrum. But still, the fossa is shallow, providing more mobility for the head of the humerus on the expense of stability. Identify the artery A. What is its origin and what is its direct continuation? Artery A is the axillary artery. It begins at the outer border of the first rib as the continuation of the subclavian artery. And the artery ends by becoming the brachial artery at the lower border of teres major muscle. Here is teres major, where the ribbon-like tendon of latissimus dorsi wraps around it. And so the artery is the axillary artery. Identify the nerve B and list two muscles supplied by the nerve in the forearm. To be oriented here about the branches and cords of the brachial plexus, and note that the cords of the brachial plexus are arranged according to their names around the second part of the axillary artery. So here we have the lateral cord, here we have the medial cord. And the posterior cord is not shown because it is posterior to the artery. Also, try to find the capital letter M, the configuration of this M, which will give you a clue for the branches and of the brachial plexus. So this is the musculocutaneous nerve, and this is the lateral and medial root of the median nerve. And here is the ulnar nerve located medially because it arises from the medial cord of the brachial plexus. the terminal branch of the medial cord of the brachial plexus. So these limbs of the M are terminal branches of lateral and medial cord of the brachial plexus. Lateral cord of the brachial plexus has terminal branches musculocutaneous and lateral root of the median nerve, and the medial cord of the brachial plexus has terminal branches ulnar and medial root of the median nerve. Now, nerve B is the median nerve. This nerve supplies nothing in the axilla, supplies nothing in the arm, and it supplies muscles mainly in the forearm and in the hand. In the forearm, it supplies the flexor muscles in the forearm, flexor group of muscles in the forearm, not all of them, but it supplies pronate arteries, flexor carpi radialis, palmaris longus, flexor digitorum superficialis, and it has a branch which is called anterior interosseous nerve that supplies flexor pollicis longus, pronator quadratus, and the lateral half of flexor digitorum profundus. Which muscle is paralyzed in this patient, and what is the root value of the nerve supplying the muscle? In the picture, we can see that there is the medial border of the right scapula appear to be projecting backwards, giving the appearance of a wing. This is accentuated as the patient's arm is passively protracted, and this condition is called winged scapula. The deformity results when serratus anterior muscle is paralyzed. This muscle forms a flat sheet of muscle that wraps around the thoracic wall and is attached to the anterior aspect of the medial border of the scapula. Thus, it pulls the medial border of the scapula forwards against the thoracic wall, and when the muscle is paralyzed, the medial border projects backwards. The muscle is supplied by long thoracic nerve. This is a supraclavicular branch of the brachial plexus. It arises from the roots of the brachial plexus, specifically from C5, 6, and 7. The long thoracic nerve is also called the nerve of Bell, hence the mnemonic C5, 6, and 7, bells of heaven. When the axillary nerve is injured, which pair of muscles is most likely affected, being supplied by that nerve? The axillary nerve is a branch of the posterior cord of the brachial plexus that supplies two muscles, and these are the deltoid and pectoralis minor muscles. Now, let's try to find these muscles in this specimen. A overlies the scapula. It is the part of trapezius that overlies the supraspinous fossa and supraspinatus muscle. B is the deltoid, one of the muscles supplied by the axillary nerve. C is teres minor, supplied by the axillary nerve. And E is the bulkier teres major muscle. So E is supplied by lower subscapular nerve, not the axillary. And D is infraspinatus, supplied by the suprascapular nerve, not the axillary nerve. Identify the artery A. What is its origin? This is a branch from the axillary artery. You can see here the axillary artery. And to be specific, it is a branch of the second part of the axillary artery. The axillary artery is divided into three parts by pectoralis minor. Here's the pectoralis minor reflected up. But if we restore its position, it will be located here, covering the axillary artery, second part of the axillary artery. So this branch, A, is a branch of the second part of the axillary artery. It's a short branch and wide branch. Sometimes it's called a trunk. It's called thoracoacromial trunk or thoracoacromial artery, and pierces the clavipectoral fascia, where it will be divided into branches toward the acromion, deltoid, pectoral muscles, and the clavicle. The second part of axillary artery has two branches, in fact. This is one of them, thoracoacromial artery. The second branch is the lateral thoracic artery. Here is the lateral thoracic artery. Usually it accompanies the long thoracic nerve here on serratus anterior muscle, but it has been cut here when the shoulder was abducted during dissection. Identify the nerve B. List two muscles supplied by the nerve in the arm. For better orientation in such dissections of the brachial plexus, we need to identify the capital M-shape configuration of the branches and cords of the brachial plexus. So this is the capital M here. It is formed by two terminal branches from the medial, from the lateral and medial cords of the brachial plexus. So B here, the lateral limb of the M, is the terminal branch of the lateral cord of the brachial plexus, that is the musculocutaneous nerve. The others are the lateral root of the median nerve, medial root of the median nerve, and the ulnar nerve. The musculocutaneous nerve disappears because it passes through the coracobrachialis muscle, which it supplies, and enters into the flexor compartment of the arm. It supplies the muscles of the flexor compartment of the arm, biceps, brachialis, and coracobrachialis. Therefore, it might be remembered as the BBC nerve. On the other hand, it is called musculocutaneous because after it supplies the three muscles, it continues as the lateral cutaneous nerve of the forearm. Identify the labeled structures A and B. What is the encircled area C? This is a venogram showing A is the cephalic vein. This is a superficial vein located in the superficial fascia. And here it is shown in the region of the deltopectoral groove. So this is a reconstruction of deltoid muscle here and pectoralis major muscle, clavicular head, and sternocostal head of pectoralis major muscle. The vein is the cephalic vein lying in the deltopectoral groove or triangle. You can see here that it bends to pierce the clavipectoral fascia and end into the vein here, the deep vein, which is the axillary vein. So the cephalic vein A ending into the axillary vein B, and then the axillary vein at the outer border of the first rib here, it forms the subclavian vein. C shows a venous valve. You can also notice the valve cusps and a small dilated sinus behind each cusp. The valves in the veins are important mechanism for circulation, returning blood to the heart against gravity. So C is a venous valve. Identify the muscles attached to the bone at A, B, and C. What is their nerve supply? The muscles attached here connect the medial border of the scapula to the cervical and upper thoracic spine. They are three muscles attached to the posterior aspect of the medial border of the scapula, levator scapulae, to the superior part of the medial border, rhomboid minor at the root of the scapular spine, rhomboid major inferior to the scapular spine. All the three muscles, they elevate and retract the scapula, and they also rotate the scapula medially so that the glenoid cavity faces downward. All the three muscles are supplied by the dorsal scapular nerve from the brachial plexus, upper trunk of the brachial plexus. A 16-year-old boy is brought to the A&D complaining of pain in his shoulder when he was struck on the edge of a door. On examination, the head of the humerus is noted to be protruding anteriorly, obscuring the deltopectoral groove. Which nerve function is being tested in this picture? And which cutaneous nerve carries sensation from this area of skin? The clinical presentation of the head of the humerus protruding anteriorly and obscuring deltopectoral groove suggests dislocation of the shoulder. And this might injure the axillary nerve passing around the surgical neck of the humerus just below the glenohumeral joint. In this case, when there is dislocation of the shoulder, it is impossible to test the integrity of the axillary nerve by testing the ability of deltoid, which is supplied by the nerve, to abduct the arm because of severe pain. But the presence of a small area of lost or diminished sensation over the inferior half of deltoid, it might enable the diagnosis. In this respect, it should be remembered that the skin over the shoulder and upper half of deltoid is supplied by supraclavicular nerves from C4, from the cervical plexus, not from the brachial plexus. But the skin over the lower half of deltoid is supplied by a branch of the axillary nerve, which is called the upper lateral cutaneous nerve of the arm. The axillary nerve supplies two muscles, deltoid anterior minor, and ends by sending a small cutaneous branch, the upper lateral cutaneous nerve of the arm, that can be used as the basis for the clinical test of the integrity of axillary nerve when the motor function of the nerve cannot be tested because of pain.